There's not a day that goes by, really, that a cyber incident is not in the news.
With the way technology has evolved, the amount of data available has increased, and there is a growing number of cybersecurity threats and data breaches. Joining me to discuss this topic is Richard Hancock, Data Protection Officer here at GlobalSign.
Organisations need to ask themselves, if we lost everything in the next 5 minutes, could we recover? Where would we be?
Welcome to Trusted Talk, where staying informed means staying secure.
Hello and welcome to another episode of Trusted Talk. I'm your host, Michelle Davidson, and today we're going to be discussing data protection, why it's no longer only a compliance requirement, it's an essential part of your cybersecurity strategy. Joining me to discuss this topic is Richard Hancock, Data Protection Officer here at GlobalSign. Hello, Richard. Thank you for joining us on the podcast.
Hi, Michelle. How are you?
I'm good, thank you. So, with the way technology has evolved and become such a massive part of our lives, the amount of data available has increased, but with that, so have the data security risks, and there is a growing number of cybersecurity threats and data breaches. Richard, can you explain why the shift is happening and what does it mean?
Well, you'll notice that there's not a day that goes by, really, that a cyber incident is not in the news in some form and some description. It's the biggest threat to our rights and freedoms, really, and that's the cornerstone of data protection and privacy legislation. And this has been going on for some decades. Overall, though, data governance plays a key role in the bigger cyber strategy and those plans. And while security measures provide, excellent defences to attack, your data protection posture can mean the difference between a severe mission critical incident and a low impact minor event. Way back when, when some of the first legislation appeared in the UK, we're talking about 1995, it was recognised that data collection, storage and use was rapidly becoming large parts of standard business operations. The 95 Act was a way to try and formalise what was fast turning into, the most valuable of your company assets, data. And since then, we've turned the corner, we've seen the trend exponentially to where we are today. And, we're seeing entire businesses where their model is just collection, storage, use, are now selling, because it's a valuable asset. It's a far cry from, back in the 90s where it was just a box-ticking exercise. We'd just done to, make the compliance guys happy. So now it's baked into our way of life and it's a key differentiator in the choice of organisation that you as a customer, voluntarily choose to do business with. I said earlier that a good data protection position can significantly mitigate a cyber incident. So if we take a look at the core data processing principles within the legislation, things like data minimization, segregation, duty separation, they all limit what a hacker could actually do in the worst case scenario. And in addition to this, data encryption is an excellent proven way to achieve mandated requirement of technical and organizational controls to secure personal data.
That is so true. As individuals and as businesses, we have certainly become more aware of how data is used, not only by companies, but also by the threat actors. The education has started. I think we've still got some way to go. You mentioned towards the end there the role of digital certificates in keeping data safe. Do you mind explaining why using strong encryption standards is crucial in preventing attacks such as man in the middle?
Yeah, so access to personal data should not only be logged for auditing in the future and checking what happened when, etc., and those types of purposes. That access should also be verified. All a username and password proves is that somebody has those credentials. It doesn't prove that it was the right somebody. So if you can imagine for a moment a world where multi-factor authentication is standard everywhere, all of those credentials out there that are stolen on the dark web, wherever they may be, they instantly become worthless. You know, and that use case can easily scale up to using a certificate in order to, you know, start your car in the morning to prove that it's really you and not a thief, or to digitally pay for goods. Certificates open up a whole, you know, world of possibilities. They play an instrumental role in the fight against fraudsters and cyber criminals. If you think TLS encrypts web traffic, SMIME certificates sign and encrypt email communication, these are all everyday use cases that we all know. However, you know, certificates have other uses too. If you think about client certificates, you know, one of the key factors that could be used in them is multi-factor authentication environments, where in addition to username and passwords, you can also request a client certificate with particular properties in order to access an asset on your environment. Strong encryption, like the use of multi-factor authentication, as I said earlier, renders stolen data worthless, since it can't be used or read by anybody. You very quickly start to see how different and better the world becomes when encryption and certificates are used in that way.
It's amazing to think that there are some people that are still just using a base password and not using tools such as multi-factor authentication, especially when it comes to securing business softwares and systems. Like, that should be, in theory, one of the first things you do in your site when looking at cybersecurity posture.
Yeah, absolutely. It should be one of the first things you do. It's so pivotal to your whole security and privacy posture.
Identity verification is crucial for preventing data breaches. You've touched on that, but also quite importantly, ensuring that trust in digital communications. So if we look at the role of certificate authorities and how we verify that identity, and also maybe touch on the importance of extended validation or EV certificates in this process, do you mind discussing that a little bit?
Sure. So, you know, as you said, I mentioned earlier, access credentials are no longer the whole piece to solving data security issues. It's so important to know that the right person is accessing the right data and for the right purposes. So if we think about Class 3 certificates with the high validation elements in both TLS and SMIME guides, they include extensive vetting of the person to whom the certificate will be issued. And therefore, you can rely on the integrity of the data that you're receiving, knowing it hasn't been altered since the author sent it. If you think about the wet ink signature was being, you know, universally accepted as a definitive contractual element for as long as we can remember, it's very reminiscent of the modern day username and password, in that somebody put that there, but who? You know, unless you are standing in the same room as them when they signed it, you have no idea who was holding that pen. So by verifying the identity of the signer in a secure, robust and trustworthy manner, a relying party, or anybody else for that matter, is assured that the person they think sent them something actually did, and that they can trust that the content is as intended. Like any responsible CA, vetting of an individual would involve a thorough checking of government-issued identification documents, verifying ownership of associated email addresses or phone numbers, and in some cases, conducting live video interviews. The goal of all of these steps is to establish a clear and auditable link between the individual and their certificate, ensuring that any and all forms of signatures made using that certificate can confidently be relied upon in a legal, commercial, and personal context. Certificate authority vetting teams have to continually evolve, continually find better and secure ways to verify information. It's because the reality is that hackers are getting more clever, more sneaky, and working smarter to steal our data. And we must adapt and work hard to stay ahead of them.
That's so true. And I think there are so many use cases where you touched on, like the wet ink signature, like in a legal setting, for example, that would be absolutely paramount to that equivalent, having that digital signature. And hackers are definitely getting smarter. They're using the same tools that we are using, and but they're using it to gain, for you know, for as bad actors to gain access to and use our data. CAs are playing a crucial role in maintaining the integrity of our digital security. And can you just elaborate a little bit on the role of CAs in auditing and how our practices help ensure the trustworthiness of digital certificates?
Yeah, so a certificate authority or CA has to go through stringent checks and audits themselves from both, you know, the browser manufacturers such as Google, Mozilla, and Apple, as well as other external regulatory bodies like the CAB Forum and WebTrust, just to operate as a business. A CA, you know, such as GlobalSign, also has a plethora of other accreditations, ranging all the way from, you know, ISO certificates on a range of standards. What this means is that when you buy a certificate from such a CA, you can be, you know, assured that the company you're dealing with has undergone all of those checks and operating in line with not only the browser programs, but also external standards requirements and their expectations. It's because of this that, you know, when you go through an audit yourselves as an end customer, all of that burden is taken away from you simply by saying that you bought from an accredited and recognized CA. That will save you time, money, and effort, since the CA takes all of that work off on your behalf.
So the trust is going both ways. You are getting trust in what you are doing with your services, but by doing so, you're instilling trust in via your customers. To your customers, not via your customers, to your customers. The right way around.
To the customers, yes.
And that's super important. Like, without that trust, how do you know, like what we were saying right at the beginning, how do you know how your data is being used? How do you ensure that you're looking after your customers' data properly? I mean, I think back to a couple of years ago where data protection maybe was not necessarily taken seriously. We had a lovely little legislation in Europe, GDPR, that made a massive difference. And I think it did put data protection more on companies' radars and take a bit more notice of it.
GDPR put data protection on the map. You know, as I mentioned earlier, you know, the UK had the 1995 Act. Other member states had their own local legislation. And what GDPR did was to unify all of that legislation so that all member states worked to the same standards and to the same set of guidelines.
That's massive. But sadly, even with it, we're still getting breaches. You know, 46% of data breaches last year involved customer personal information. That's still a staggering number. And yes, it's under half of those that were surveyed in the report, you know, for the report, but that's still quite a staggering number. But the cost to the business is also massive. You know, that last year, the global average cost of data breach spiked by 10%. It was nearly 5 million. I think it was 4.88 was the exact figure or something like that. And that was a 10% increase on 2023. So that's a really big shift. So it's not just impacting customers and how their data is being used by the hackers, and it's also has that cost impact to the businesses and that organization.
Those numbers are staggering and very worrying. They are far too high for, you know, a 2025 world.
We have a regular segment here on the podcast. It's our Mythbuster. It's where we address common myth or misconception. This can be an overarching topic or maybe terminology that we like to just delve into a little bit and get people's perspectives on. So Richard, do you have a myth that we could unpick a little bit in this podcast?
I think, you know, when I speak to organisations, what really comes across to me is, you know, the approach of "it will never happen to me," or, you know, "I read about these things in the news." I'm not sure I'd go as far as to say, you know, that's complacency, but it is certainly not if but when approach that it really should be. You know, unfortunately, we live in a world where hacks, compromise, breach are to be expected. And as such, they need to be planned for appropriately. You know, this is exactly why we see incident response plans, backups, contingency exercises. You know, organizations need to ask themselves, you know, if we lost everything in the next 5 minutes, you know, could we recover? Where would we be? What would that look like? I think that idea of it happened to somebody else is, you know, amongst one of the biggest myths that we have.
I think that's really important. And it's something that we do get a bit complacent in terms of, oh, no, this is fine. It's not going to happen to me. And when it does, we all kind of go, oh, no, what are we going to do? And that goes both on a personal level, yeah. But also more importantly, in this context, for the organizations, like you say, how can a business survive if they were to be attacked in the 5 minutes and they lost everything? Because that can happen. But there are ways, like we've discussed in the episode today, that companies can build in that security posture and protect that data throughout all of what they're doing at their cybersecurity strategies.
So absolutely, you're right there, Michelle. You know, security and data protection, there is significant overlap, and, you know, you can't be strong in one area and weak in another. They go hand in hand. But when they do, you know, you have a good defense to the risks in today's world.
We like to end our podcast by asking each of our guests, what is your favourite tech that you can't live without and why?
Well, for me personally, I couldn't live without my digital wallet. You know, in a time where identity theft and fraud are on the rise, you know, it takes seconds to clone payment cards such as physical debit or credit. But when you use a digital wallet such as Apple Pay or Google Pay, a pseudonymized version of your card number is transmitted to the merchant while your original card number never leaves your device. It stays there encrypted, nice and safe. My physical payment cards are stored in my safe and therefore, you know, unable to be scanned by passerbys using, you know, a reader that you can pick up off eBay. You know, if you set these things up correctly, you know, i.e. turn on the require verification before payment setting, then, you know, digital wallets are not vulnerable to that risk. I can't remember the last time I used a physical card, you know, and hence, you know, that's the tech that I really couldn't live without today.
And they're evolving as well, aren't they? You know, there are regulations coming into play with the eIDAS 2.0 where digital identity wallets are becoming more of a thing. And I hadn't realized until our conversation now how secure digital wallets were. It was really interesting having this conversation around data protection and how it plays a bigger part of cybersecurity strategy than maybe we realized. And I'd like to thank you for joining us on the podcast today, Richard.
No problem. It's a pleasure. I enjoyed talking about data protection, you know, and how impacts the world in very real terms.
And I'd like to thank our listeners for tuning in. And this has been Trusted Talk. Until next time.
Thank you for tuning into Trusted Talk, the Digital Certificate and Identity Security Podcast. Today's episode wasn't just about information. It was about arming you with the knowledge to make critical security decisions immediately. If this episode gave you practical takeaways, don't wait. Subscribe to Trusted Talk on your favorite podcast platform and consider leaving a review to help other security professionals discover these essential insights. For even more urgent resources, like regulatory updates and automation tools, head over to globalsign.com. Join us next time as we tackle another pressing topic in digital identity and crypto agility. Until then, stay proactive, stay secure, and thank you for listening.